Hi, Dia. Hi.
Hi, I found the sunniest spot in the house to have this conversation with you because the Wi-Fi was strongest over here. I hope you
Okay, it
can hear
doesn't matter. I can hear you. Hope everybody can hear you.
Yes, everybody just give us a thumbs up if you can hear us clearly. And of course, if you can hear the crickets and the.
Yes, it's lovely to see sunshine today after yesterday's devastating news. And thank you so much for doing this. It's been a long time coming.
Yes, it has, and I'm so grateful that you're having these conversations. I've known you such a long time, and I've always admired you for your peace, your fortitude, your love, and your kindness. So thank you for having me.
Thank you for being here, and I've always admired you for the wonderful human being that you are, for all that you do for this planet. And I love the fact that when I asked you to do a talk on self-care, you've extended it out into the onto the planet and making us responsible for our children's future as guardians of nature. I think that's just wonderful. So would you tell me a little bit more about this? Would you tell the audience how you got to this place?
I think, Nandini, there are a few things that we all need to understand a little better. You know, when we talk about health, most often we neglect or we forget the fact that our health, our well-being, everything that we need every single day in our life comes from nature. And it's quite pointless to, you know, do yoga and asanas and meditation if you're doing it in smog and pollution. And that image itself, I think, should be description enough of what it means to understand how interconnected human health and life and sustenance is with the natural world, and how important it is for us as people to recognize that connection and do all we can to restore the health of the environment. And more so now, I feel, as a parent, while you know it can be debilitating at times when you're surrounded by the news that you are, you know, climate change has become so evident. It's reached home. When we were younger, we used to hear about melting icebergs and glaciers, which were far away from us. So we didn't really understand it so much, or we didn't understand the immediacy or the urgency of the issue. But today we are experiencing climate change at home, in our neighborhoods, in our cities, in our countries. And along with that, there is the crisis of pollution, which is something that we're all experiencing, of course, whether it is air pollution or it's water pollution, or it's the pollution of plastics. Where microplastics have now been found in placenta, in the bloodstream of babies, in breast milk. And so much of how we behave, how we consume, what we do, and what kind of choices we make as individuals and as parents, it's so important to understand all of that because if you really care for the health and the future of our children, we all need to do more to restore the health of our environment and the health of our planet.
Absolutely. And where did this love for the other and love for looking after the earth start?
I think it all starts at home, right, Nandini? It starts with the way we see our parents perceive the world around them. I think it all started with my mother and her sense of wonder and awe and love for nature, the fact that she would spend hours planting in the garden and talking to her plants and trees, teaching me the various names of, you know, the plants and the trees that we grew, and helping me understand that my existence was not separate from the natural world. And then, of course, this wonderful school that I went to in Hyderabad, Vidyaranya, which directly translates to forest of education. We spent so much time outdoors. We spent so much time climbing trees, plucking fruit, watching birds build nests, watching seasons change, understanding that interconnectedness. But, you know, earlier in the day today, when I was thinking about this conversation, I was reminded of this book that I read as a child. Of course, the fact that my parents were so in love with nature and spent so much time outdoors and therefore, you know, inculcated that habit in me as well. Alongside that, my love for books. And there was this one particular book called The Secret Garden. I'm sure you read it as a
Yes.
And, you know, Nandini, when I read The Secret Garden, I, of course, loved it. But the one thing that that book did for me was, at a very young age, it helped me understand that nature is healing. You know, how that little boy who's almost dying, who's frail, who's weak, who has no strength and no color in his skin, is locked away in a cold, dark, like room in the basement of the house. Yeah. And this, the action of that little girl taking him into the secret garden in the wheelchair every day, and how bit by bit, as the garden emerges and comes back to life, this child's strength comes back to his limbs and his body, and how eventually he walks out of the wheelchair, and I'm getting goosebumps to share this. You know, that understanding is invaluable. And I think that more and more people now are beginning to understand how nature heals, how being connected with the natural world makes all the difference, which is why I think one of the things that we always share with people is go out, you know, spend more time outdoors, spend more time under the shade of a tree, watch, you know, flowers bloom, plant more trees if you can. It's the best
thing. It's so sad that, like, I know I spent my whole childhood climbing trees, you know, lying on the beach, walking on the rocks. And I don't, where do children climb trees anymore? I mean, I can see trees in your garden.
Yeah, some of our children, and thankfully there are many more who are now discovering it, because parents are also understanding how important it is for children to spend time outdoors. But there was a survey done in the United Kingdom a few years ago where children had not seen the stars or the moon because they spent so much time indoors. And I think that there is a privilege in being able to interact with nature every day. And we must never, ever forget that. And I try as much as I can to make sure Avyan spends time in nature every single day. And he knows my favorite tree's name. And he knows... recently a very dear friend of ours, you know, gave him the most precious gift. She helped him discover the journey of a caterpillar to a butterfly. And it was beautiful, because all day after the butterfly had been set free, after it had emerged, and he had patiently waited for 8 days for the, you know, the caterpillar to turn into the butterfly, all day he kept asking me, but where did the butterfly go? So nothing. Yes. I think empathy is something that you can learn from nature better than any other place.
I agree. It's you learn it by osmosis. You learn it organically. The time you spend looking at the stars. Or I know when we were kids, my father could name every bird, every tree, every plant, every constellation. You know, I mean, that, there was something so innocent and so beautiful and so heart moving in knowing nature and loving nature, which I think
we see that even in Ruskin Bond's books, right?
Yes.
I remember doing a conversation with him, and I asked him, I said, are you a naturalist? Are you a trained naturalist? Because you seem to know every bird's name. Yes. And he said, no, but when you spend so much time in nature, you're curious. You want to know the names. You witness the birds and the bird song. You know the difference, and you discover things along the way. And I think that more and more people now are beginning to discover the virtue in that, and the merits in that, and the power, most importantly.
There really is. There's a power in honoring nature, as you said. There's such a power in respecting something that actually sustains us, without which we wouldn't be talking to each other here. I have a friend, in fact, we have a common friend, Marion, and if ever I want to go ask her, yeah, so a bird sound, I'll record it and I'll send it to her and say, Marion, which bird is this? She knows the birds. And that's so beautiful. That is really being a guardian and honoring our planet and nature is you know, respecting the trees and the birds, plants, and tell me about plastic and why you call yourself an eco-investor.
Okay, so I'm an eco-investor because I believe that if we can put our money behind companies and organizations and individuals who are working towards creating a sustainable change, who are working towards making products available to us that are made from natural resources and are done in a very sustainable way, where not only is the planet, but also people equally honored in the process, that's the only way we can, you know, bring about big change. Because unfortunately for all of us, a majority of the products that we consume in our everyday lives that are available in the mainstream market are not necessarily good for our health and are not necessarily good for the health of the environment. And while, you know, sustainable products are not the norm yet, yes, when they should be,
yes,
it will require for all of us to start investing our money and our time and, of course, start consuming these products more frequently, so that these products become the norm and become available and accessible to everyone. That's why I'm an eco-investor, because I think there is no better and bigger way than to invest in companies that are making true impact. So, I mean, some of the brands that I've managed to discover along the way, whether it's Bico or Alter or Shumi or Green Bico, these are products I discovered when I was looking for sustainable alternatives for my child when he was born.
Yes.
So Alter happened to me because I didn't want to use regular diapers, given that they are, you know, laced with over 8,000 chemicals. They're made mostly with plastic. They're harmful to the environment and extremely harmful for the child. So I was like, I need an alternative. Is there one that is being manufactured in India? And I discovered Alter. And that's when I started using Alter. And then I decided to invest in Alter.
Oh.
Similarly, I had the same experience even with Bico. I started using Bico. And then I said, this is a fantastic brand. They're doing great work. You know, they're giving me a substitute for bleached, you know, chemical filled toilet paper and tissue paper and face napkins with you know, bamboo alternative, which is natural and chemical free.
Yes.
So this is something that I want to invest in. And when I was looking for toys that were not made of plastic, I wanted, you know, old school wooden toys that were,
yes,
Montessori based, that were educational, but at the same time had, you know, gave the child the freedom to have, you know, play in his or her way. I discovered Shumi and I was like, this is fantastic. And interestingly, most of these brands have been started by women and mothers.
Yeah,
and
truly take care.
Yeah, and the same was with Green Bico. I was looking for clothes that were free of chemicals and toxins. And I wanted something that, you know, was certified and internationally certified, and I could know that my child's skin would be safe in the care of this cloth and this clothing, and that's how I found Green Bico. So I think a lot of my choices have been a result of my own personal endeavor to discover better alternatives and then, of course, back them. Nandini, when it comes to plastic, I can have a 5-hour conversation, maybe a longer conversation with you.
Okay.
But you know, about 8 years ago, people used to ask me, what is your biggest nightmare? And
yes,
I would say, waking up to a world that is covered in plastic. And unfortunately, I think that nightmare has come true.
Yes.
Because the quantum of plastics that human beings have created to package practically everything that we use in our everyday lives with absolutely no accountability for how that plastic waste is going to be managed, is what has resulted in what we're seeing today.
Yeah.
Of course, the visible experiences, seeing the volumes of plastic waste that we see on our beaches, in our rivers, in our lakes, in our ponds, our water bodies. We see it, you know, lying in heaps or are forming ravines across our mountains where they're being set to fire because we don't have to select the waste. But who is talking about it? Who is accounting for the microplastics that have made their way into the bloodstream of babies or has made its way into breast milk or placenta? I read a recent report where they've even found plastic, microplastics in testicles. So I read that and I said, well, maybe this will make the men in the business sit up a little and say, hey, maybe it's time to change.
Let's do something now.
Yeah. But having said that, I'm very, very encouraged by the fact that the world is working towards a strong plastics treaty. Negotiations have started. My fingers are crossed. I'm really praying hard that, you know, the fossil fuel companies don't push back and they recognize the problems that they've created and they work with everyone, including industries, including companies, including governments, policymakers, and individuals, to bring the change in systems that we need to fix the problem that we're dealing with. Because right now, we may not be able to link the presence of plastics in human body directly with a rise in cancer or a rise in nervous system disorders or autoimmune diseases or other, you know, illnesses that we're dealing with. But it's not hard to imagine a substance like plastic present in our body causing some serious issues. I mean, a recent report even suggested that human beings are consuming a credit card size of plastic a week through the indirect, you know, consumption. So when everything that you're eating and drinking is coming in plastic, it's going to find its way into your bloodstream, into your body. So, so my big mission has been for the longest time to get more and more individuals to start refusing single-use plastics, because I think that's the first and the immediate thing that we can get rid of from our lives. And then, of course, move beyond that and pressure, you know, companies that are making our consumer goods and are making food and beverage and packaging, everything that we need to eat.
Capsules.
Well, you know, the thing with plastics is it is also a life-saving material.
Yes.
It is. Medicines are being made accessible to parts of the world that would not have been had access to medicines because they're packaged the way they are. But beyond that, and we can't use that as the reason to continue creating the damage that we are. So I'm hoping that a lot will change, but change can happen from, you know, just individual action as well. And I think a lot of pressure now. It continues to mount on governments, on policymakers, on industries to ensure that there is something called extended producer's responsibility and that there is something called, you know, alternatives and the sustainable options that are now becoming more frequently and easily available. So innovation is really driving that change.
And I think for things like that, like for plastic, you have to give the general janta, the everyday person, doable goals. If you make it too extreme, no one's going to even try. It has to be something doable.
You know, Nandini, when we speak about, when we talk
nobody's
about sustainability,
getting that this is something that's killing us. No one's getting that.
But for the common man who is struggling to make ends meet, who is working hard, who's labor, who's out in the heat every day dealing with the enormity of just working in the circumstances and conditions that he or she is, and is challenged by, you know, the everyday battles of life that they're already having to deal with. Then when you tell them, listen, you can't use plastic, you can't use this, you have to segregate your waste, they're not going to be able to do it. So it's upon those who have the privilege and the time to be able to do these things, do more of it. And the most important is that these things need to be cut off at source. So it has to be a top-down approach. It can't be a bottom-up approach. And we've been doing it completely wrong so far. Where we've been trying to get human behavior to change, and human behavior is where people don't have the time. They just don't.
Absolutely.
So, you know, Nandini, I just want to take this moment, because there are lots of people here who want us to acknowledge what's happening in Gaza. And I think we should. I think there are it's just this whole thing has been a nightmare that has to end. It just has to end. Every person who has a heart in this world has eyes on Gaza right now, and their hearts are in deep pain for what the people in Gaza are experiencing.
Yes, it's global burning. Yes, it is. It's. I mean, there are no words to describe the pain everybody's feeling.
And I think that anyone who minimizes the pain of anyone, any other person, whatever the reason for that may be, is doing a great injustice to humanity. And I think that the world really, really needs to start focusing on just this basic thing that we've been talking about from the beginning of this conversation, which is that spirit of oneness, that understanding that we're all connected, that we can't be separated from each other, just like we can't exist without breathing the breath of air that is created by the leaves and the trees that we're surrounded by. Similarly, we can't move forward without strength and love and that understanding that we're all interdependent. We belong to each other.
In you, I see me. And in me, I found you. In you, I see me, and in me, I found. It's really what your WhatsApp status, Ubuntu. Because you are, I am, Ubuntu. We need to say that, because you are, I am. It's very sad.
Would you like to take some questions that people are asking?
Yes, I would. It's like a sitting bomb. It's true, and it keeps, they are bleeding. Human beings are bleeding. Banning policy should be done at every level. What you're saying is good on paper, but not on reality. But that's why she said the common man can't do it. Somebody's asking about web series. When is your next web series?
Oh my god, there's a very, very beautiful one that has been announced, so I can talk about it. Very powerful one, maybe would be the wrong word. IC 814, directed by Anubhav Sinha, that should be releasing this year. I'm very, very excited about it. It's a powerful story. He's one of my favorite directors, so I'm looking forward to that.
And somebody was asking, what was your experience in Thappad?
I think Thappad came into my life at a time when I needed it. And it did very interesting things for me. Firstly, I think it was a privilege to be a part of a powerful story that so many people have watched and loved. And I had a chance to, get back into the world of films. I've done three of his films in the past when Anubhav was a totally different filmmaker, and then to be able to work with this Anubhav Sinha, who's questioning and is really, really working on subjects that truly impact change, is such an honor and privilege. So Thappad led to Bheed, and now Bheed has led to IC 814, and I'm so happy about that. Thank you. Somebody just said they
love your work and You would have been perfect in Heera Mandi. I agree. I agree with that. Somebody asked, what are your new projects?
I've just mentioned IC814 is what I can talk about. Yes. There's two other things I'm working on, which I can't really announce just yet.
Okay.
Oh, I like how somebody just said, Nandini, you're my all-time crush.
Well, I don't have curly hair. My hair is straight, but it's become curly now. Crush of my life, Diya Mirza. Too much disturbance of air, but yeah. You have beautiful eyes.
You're not able to hear me clearly.
I can hear you clearly, but there is air. That's what we're doing, nature. Stand with Palestine. Allah, my all-time favorite girl. Yes, even mine. Somebody's asking about mainstream film.
What about that?
One second. So many questions coming one after the other that it's gone.
Okay, then you don't worry yourself about it.
Okay,
we'll just wrap up the conversation the way you.
In India, we had issues with plastic bans not implemented well.
So we campaigned really hard for a single-use plastics ban. Finally, we got a ban of 21 items.
Okay.
2022. And unfortunately, as we can all see, and it's quite evident, in most states, the ban has not been implemented. But that's also, again, a result of the fact that there is a very, very powerful lobby at work that supports and funds, you know, elections and politicians. So it becomes hard to implement bans, which is why I think what we really need to work on and continue to strive for is policy change, strong laws, and the top-down approach, which is we need companies to change, we need industries to change, we need the world to collectively acknowledge that plastics are bad for human health.
Yes, absolutely.
And to be managed much more wisely and much more scientifically than we have.
Absolutely. So, Diya, will you give me three of your life lessons that you've learned on the way about self-care? Could be anything. Three.
I think, the first is interact with nature every day. Find a way to ground yourself, walk bare feet in soil or in grass. Spend half an hour, 45 minutes, in a clean, open space. Do it. Do it regularly. Do it every single day. It is life altering. The second thing that has been extremely beneficial to me in my most tumultuous times where I've had to deal with, very big challenges, heartache, pain, fear, all kinds of things, failure. Is meditation. I found that meditation has a way of really grounding you and making you feel more balanced and centered. And the third thing that I have done regularly for most of my adult life now that I think is a very powerful tool for self-care and self-love is regular exercise. When your endorphins are released in your body and you're able to, walk about and move. So move a lot, walk a lot, stand a lot. Even if you're not doing your conventional workouts, or you're not doing yoga, or you're not doing Pilates or whatever fancy thing, just make sure at least you're walking 10,000 steps a day. These three things have proven to be deeply beneficial to me, and I would ask everyone to practice the same.
So one is connect with nature every day, walk barefoot if you can. Second is meditate, that has held you through very, very tough times in your life. And third is move. So every Friday at 11, I do a short move with me at every Monday and every Friday I do meditation at 11. So I'm in sync with you.
As you are, and it shows.
I do it live on Instagram.
I know, I've been following you. I've also watched many of your sessions during the lockdown, and I thought that was so beneficial to everyone.
Thank you so much, Nia. One last mantra for life.
Surrender.
Yes.
I've just surrendered to the universe.
Yeah.
I think that it can be so bewildering and terrifying and heartbreaking to live and be conscious of the realities that we are surrounded with every day. And there's so much pain in our world, and there's so much that's happening around us that can be so debilitating. But I think what crushes most of us is, you know, the knowledge that we can't change everything and we can't fix everything. But what can I do in my everyday life? Can I be kind? Yes. Can I spread more love? Yes. Can I treat more people with respect and equality?
Yes.
Yes. And then just surrender. So I think there is a deep meaning in recognizing that, you know, we are all instruments of change, and we can bring about big changes by just, you know, doing our bit, what we can every day, and surrendering.
Once again, I just like to spend.
I can hear my mom's voice in my head saying gratitude, attitude of gratitude. So yes,
gratitude. Mom is wonderful. Please give her a big hug for me. And before we sign off, just a few seconds, let's just pray for everybody's pain. Just a few seconds. Pray for peace and some sort of resolution. Thank you so much, Diya. Love you.
Love you too. And thank you everyone for joining us. So many of you stuck around right through this conversation. Thank you.
I am because you are.